Good morning. This weekend, we will be using a new setting of the Gloria. As we review it before Mass begins, please turn to the Gloria on the inside of the pew worship aid. I will sing the first part once and then invite you to sing it again with me. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of goodwill. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you. We glorify you, we give you thanks for your great glory. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of goodwill. We praise you, we bless you, we adore. We will skip ahead towards the last part of the Gloria that begins with the words, "For you alone are the Holy One." I will sing it once and then invite you to sing it again with me. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ.
Good morning, and welcome on the third Sunday in Ordinary Time. A warm welcome to our parishioners and everyone visiting us this weekend. Our special collection is for the Diocese Respect Life Fund. The fund supports activities that protect and promote the dignity of human life from conception to natural death. Grants are given each year to Catholic parishes to pursue local efforts and initiatives that promote direct services, education, and advocacy to alleviate or end threats to human life. We thank you for your generosity. Our parish depends on and thanks you for your continued financial support in order to meet the many spiritual and material needs of our parishioners and our local community. You may place both your parish offering and your marked envelope for the Diocesan Respect Life Fund in the wooden collection boxes in the baptistry. Tickets for our annual father-daughter dance are now available in the Commons this weekend and next. The dance is held on Friday, February 3rd at 6:30 p.m. in Kaplan Parish Hall. The evening includes food, dancing, and fun. Due to no daily masses this week, our regularly scheduled Holy Hour with exposition of the Blessed Sacrament will be at 9 a.m. until benediction at 10 a.m. on Monday and Friday. Catholic Schools Week begins next Sunday. Our area Catholic schools, including Our Lady of Mount Carmel, Peninsula Catholic High School, and Walsingham Academy, invite you to learn about their school and the gift of Catholic education. Visit the tables in the Commons for more information. Now, please welcome a representative from Walsingham Academy.
Good morning. I would like to thank Father Kyle for the opportunity to speak this morning. My name is Ashley Miller, and I'm a third grade teacher at Walsingham Academy. I'm honored to be able to invite you to Walsingham Academy's open house on Friday, January 27th. Founded by the Sisters of Mercy, Walsingham has a long history of providing a meaningful educational experience for students from pre-K through 12th grade. As a teacher, I have the privilege of giving my students academic support and encouragement in an environment of love and faith. The gift of a rigorous education is enhanced when it is accompanied by daily religious instruction that honors the strengths and God-given talents of each child. As a parent of two boys who attend Walsingham, I feel blessed to be able to provide my most precious gifts with a loving, faith-based learning experience. It is clear to me my children are growing into happy students who know they are loved and valued as a part of the Walsingham family. Their enthusiasm for learning is a result of being in an enriching, thoughtful learning environment, and my husband and I couldn't ask for anything more. We will soon be celebrating Catholic Schools Week along with Our Lady of Mount Carmel and Peninsula Catholic. I hope you will be able to visit our special community on Friday, January 27th. Reservations are required. We ask that you go to our website or contact Ashley Silver, our Director of Admissions. I promise you, you will be welcome to a beautiful campus, meet our wonderful faculty members, and see some of the amazing work produced by our students. Thank you.
The presider at this Mass is Father Kyle O'Connor, assisted by Deacon Greg Ballantyne. Please stand and greet those around you.
Join in singing number 766, You Walk Along Our Shoreline, number 766.
Oh, name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. The Lord be with you. Brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries.
You are sent to heal the contrite of heart. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You came to call sinners. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
You are seated at the right hand of the Father to intercede for us. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Let us pray. Almighty ever-living God, direct our actions according to your good pleasure, that in the name of your beloved Son, we may abound in good works. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. First the Lord degraded the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, but in the end he glorified the seaward road, the land west of the Jordan, the district of the Gentiles. Anguish has taken wing, dispelled is darkness, for there is no gloom where but now there was distress. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Upon those who dwell in the land of gloom, a light has shone. You have brought them abundant joy and great rejoicing, as they rejoice before you as at the harvest, as people make merry when dividing spoils. For the yoke that burdened them, the pole on their shoulder, and the rod of their taskmaster you have smashed as on the day of Midian. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Whom should I dread? The Lord is my light and my salvation. There is one thing I ask of the Lord. Only this do I seek, to live in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze on the beauty of the Lord, to inquire at his temple. The Lord is my salvation. I believe I shall see the Lord's goodness in the land of the living. Wait for the Lord, be strong, be stout-hearted, and wait for the Lord. Lord is my light and my salvation.
A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. I urge you, brothers and sisters, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that all of you agree in what you say, and that there be no divisions among you, but that you be united in the same mind and in the same purpose. For it has been reported to me about you, my brothers and sisters, by Chloe's people, that there are rivalries among you. I mean that each of you is saying, I belong to Paul, I belong to Apollos, or I belong to Cephas, or I belong to Christ. Is Christ divided? Was Paul crucified for you? Or were you baptized in the name of Paul? For Christ did not send me to baptize, but to preach the gospel, and not send with the wisdom of human eloquence, so that the cross of Christ might not be emptied of its meaning. The word of the Lord.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. When Jesus heard that John had been arrested, he withdrew to Galilee. He left Nazareth and went to live in Capernaum by the sea, in the region of Zebulun and Naphtali, that what had been said through Isaiah the prophet might be fulfilled. Land of Zebulun and land of Naphtali, the way to the sea beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles, the people who sit in darkness have seen a great light. On those dwelling in a land overshadowed by death, light has arisen. From that time on, Jesus began to preach and say, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." As he was walking by the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon, who is called Peter, and his brother Andrew. Casting a net into the sea, they were fishermen. He said to them, "Come after me, and I will make you fishers of men." At once they left their nets and followed him. He walked along from there and saw two other brothers, James, the son of Zebedee, and his brother John. They were in a boat with their father Zebedee, mending their nets. He called them, and immediately they left their boat and their father and followed him. He went around all of Galilee, teaching in their synagogues, proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom, and curing every disease and illness among the people. The gospel of the Lord. The way to know Jesus, if I may be so bold, is to look at, to pay great attention to what he says and what he does. And we know what he says and does through Scripture. Scripture tells us what we need to know about him and also about us. For example, we have heard Jesus request many times in Scripture, "Follow me. Come after me. Come and see." He calls us into a relationship, into friendship with us. Why is this so important? Because Jesus is saying to each one of us, "Come after me. Follow me. Come and see." It is Jesus' invitation to every one of us to step into the fullness of our life. It's a call to become fully alive. It's about becoming more authentically ourselves, living with integrity and discovering our truest self. To put it another way, he asks us to engage the world and others with the heart of God. Through Scripture, we pay attention to what he says and does, but he also, and more importantly, he offers us an experience. He offers us a journey with him. Follow me. Come after me, come and see, isn't only about going somewhere, it's also about leaving behind. That's the hard part for most of us. We're pretty good at accumulating and clinging, but not so good at letting go. More often than not, however, growth involves some kind of letting go. We accept Jesus' invitation to follow by letting go of that which keeps us from knowing him more, and more importantly, Jesus knowing us. Maybe letting go of something else to take time to pray and meditate on the sacred text is a key part of building our relationship with the Lord. Pope Francis declared that the third Sunday in ordinary time is to be devoted to the celebration, study, and dissemination of the Word of God. He stated that the Bible is the book of the Lord's people, and that it belongs to those called to hear its message and to recognize themselves in the words. This declaration to establish today as the Sunday of the Word of God is, of course, not meant for just a day, but as a lifelong endeavor so that we may grow in our knowledge and our love of Scripture, and to have, as it says in Paul's letter to the Philippians, the supreme good of knowing Christ Jesus, our Lord. The Bible is indeed the greatest book ever written. It has shaped the cultures of the world in countless ways, and it contains the words of everlasting life. Within Scripture, we begin to answer two fundamental questions. Who is God, and who is Jesus Christ? The Bible focuses a particular light on the peculiar, and at times unnerving, an endlessly fascinating figure that is to be at the very heart of the biblical story, namely the God of Israel, and on the one who St. Paul characterized as the image of the invisible God, that is, the first century Jewish teacher who spoke and acted in the very person of God, and who now reigns as the risen Lord of all creation. The Bible is not so much a book as it is a library, a collection of books. The library that is the Bible contains 73 books written by a wide variety of authors, addressed to different audiences at different moments in history, and employing an abundance of literary categories. With that said, despite this sometimes complex variety, the Bible ultimately tells one great story, one continuously unfolding great story. St. Augustine proposed Jesus' command to love God above all else and our neighbor for the sake of God as the ultimate criterion for reading Scripture. In other words, every story, poem, doctrine, or saying in the Bible should be to instill love of God and neighbor. Their purpose is to tell the great story of Israel, which reaches its climax in the dying and rising of the Messiah, and to bring all people into communion with Jesus Christ. So what is Scripture, and how can our greater understanding of it enhance, enrich, and strengthen our lives and faith? Within the Bible is the great story, the journeys from the extraordinary beginning, where darkness covered everything, to standing before the triumphant throne of God. Within it lies a journey that shows us the way to understand who we are and what we are to become. It includes great and historic people. It includes troubled families, war and peace, miracles and messages to teach us. It is an unparalleled narrative. In a world of continuous noise, distraction, anxiety, and uncertainty, it calls us to face the reality that while we have failed by our sin, we are redeemable through the sacrifice of Christ. With great love and strong assurance, Scripture affirms that we are beloved children of God. Scripture is meant to form us. The gospel shows us the life of God, the wisdom of God that allows us to embrace Him, who came to be with His creation, and it gave us a template, a mold, a pattern, a guide for who we are to strive to be. Scripture reminds us that we are not alone. It emboldens us in our faith that grows into a friendship with our Creator. In Scripture, we see that God is knowable, accessible, intimately interactive, and responsive to His people. And our regular reading of and contemplation of and sharing of Scripture is a key part of our actively seeking to know and to love God more deeply. Our study of Scripture is a lifelong endeavor that is a key part of our journey of faith as we grow in friendship with our Creator. In other words, Scripture is an invitation to know the loving God. The Old Testament prophetically points to Christ. The New Testament shows us God made man, that is, the life of God on earth, the wisdom of God who came to be with us. It provides us with an intimacy that allows us to bring our fear and brokenness to the embrace of Christ who makes us all whole again. Have you ever had the feeling that you just had to do something, even though you didn't exactly know where it would take you or what would happen? It didn't just feel right, it felt necessary. And to do otherwise would be a betrayal of your life and your very self. Maybe that's how Simon and Andrew, James and John felt. Maybe that's what it feels like to answer Jesus' call, follow me, come after me, come and see.
I believe in one God, the Father. To come. Amen. And trusting in the goodness of our Heavenly Father, we turn to Him now to present our prayers and petitions.
For all Christians, divided and often ignorant of each other, may we, in this week of prayer for Christian unity, work to move beyond the quarrels of the past and bring to fruition Christ's prayer, that all may be one. We pray. Lord, hear our prayer. For countries overshadowed by the violence of war, may they soon see the joyful dawning of peace. We pray. Lord, hear our prayer. For all who struggle in the yoke of addiction, may God's grace free them to turn from sin and follow Him. We pray. Lord, hear our prayer. For medical professionals, may their work be rooted in a deep respect for life from conception to natural death. We pray. Lord, hear our prayer. For our lectors who proclaim the scriptures at every Mass, may they do so with deep faith and confident voice, announcing God's saving word. We pray. Lord, hear our prayer. For every child in their mother's womb, may their lives be seen as a gift and masterpiece of God's creation. We pray. Lord, hear our prayer. For members of our parish who suffer any anguish of body, mind, or spirit, may the light of God's healing shine upon them. We pray. Lord, hear our prayer. For all who belong to Christ in life and have gone before us in death, including the recently deceased, David Loring, Donald Ouellette, may the light of Christ scatter the darkness for them and for all who mourn their passing. We pray. Lord, hear our prayer.
And together now let us pray the Memorare to St. Joseph found on the prayer cards in your pew. Remember, O most chaste spouse of the Virgin Mary,
that never was it known anyone who failed to thy protection implored thy help, or sought thy intercession, was left unaided. Inspired by this confidence, we fly unto you, our spiritual Father, and beg your protection. O guardian of the Redeemer, despise not our petitions, but in your goodness, hear and answer us.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Accept our offerings, O Lord, we pray, and in sanctifying them, grant that they may profit us for salvation through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, almighty and eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For through his paschal mystery, he accomplished the marvelous deed by which he has freed us from the yoke of sin and death, summoning us to the glory of being now called a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for your own possession, to proclaim everywhere your mighty works, for you have called us out of darkness into your own wonderful light. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the host and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim. To you, therefore, most merciful Father, we make humble prayer and petition through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, that you accept and bless these gifts, these offerings, these holy and unblemished sacrifices, which we offer you firstly for your holy Catholic Church. Be pleased to grant her peace, to guard, unite, and govern her throughout the whole world, together with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Barry, our Bishop, and all those who, holding to the truth, hand on the Catholic and apostolic faith. Remember, Lord, your servants. And all gathered here whose faith and devotion are known to you, for them we offer you the sacrifice of praise, where they offer it for themselves and all who are dear to them, for the redemption of their souls and hope of health and well-being, and paying their homage to you, the eternal God, living and true. In communion with those whose memory we venerate, especially the glorious ever-Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord Jesus Christ, and blessed Joseph, her spouse, your blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew, James, John, Thomas, James, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Simon, and Jude, Linus, Cletus, Clement, Sixtus, Cornelius, Cyprian, Lawrence, Chrysogonus, John and Paul, Cosmas and Damian, and all your saints. We ask that through their merits and prayers in all things, we may be defended by your protecting help. Therefore, Lord, we pray, graciously accept this oblation of our service, that of your whole family, order our days in your peace, and command that we be delivered from eternal damnation and counted among the flock of those you have chosen. Be pleased, O God, we pray, to bless, acknowledge, and approve this offering in every respect. Make it spiritual and acceptable, so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands, and with eyes raised to heaven, to you, O God, his almighty Father, giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands, and once more giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
The mystery of faith.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the Blessed Passion, the resurrection from the dead, and the glorious ascension into heaven of Christ your Son, our Lord, we, your servants and your holy people, offer to your glorious majesty from the gifts that you have given us this pure victim, this holy victim, this spotless victim, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Be pleased to look upon these offerings with a serene and kindly countenance, and to accept them as once you were pleased to accept the gifts of your servant Abel the Just, the sacrifice of Abraham, our father in faith, and the offering of your high priest Melchizedek, a holy sacrifice, a spotless victim. In humble prayer, we ask you, Almighty God, command that these gifts be borne by the hands of your holy angel to your altar on high, in the sight of your divine majesty, so that all of us who through this participation at the altar receive the most holy body and blood of your Son, may be filled with every grace and heavenly blessing. Remember also, Lord, your servants who have gone before us with the sign of faith and rest in the sleep of peace. Grant them, O Lord, we pray, and all who sleep in Christ, a place of refreshment, light, and peace. To us also, your servants, who though sinners, hope in your abundant mercies, graciously grant some share and fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicity, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and all your saints. Admit us, we beseech you, into their company, not weighing our merits, but granting us your pardon, through Christ our Lord, through whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord. You sanctify them, fill them with life, bless them and bestow them upon us. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Let us offer each other a sign of peace.
Thank you.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Join in singing number 760, Lord, When You Came, number 760.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Grant, we pray, Almighty God, that receiving the grace by which you bring us to new life, we may always glory in your gift through Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated for just a moment. Just a brief announcement. As you might imagine, now that William and Mary has started back up, there's going to be some changes in the liturgy schedule this week and then going forward as well. So we apologize for the disruption, but there will be no daily Mass here at St. Bede for this entire week. So there's still, as was mentioned at the beginning of the Mass, some holy hours on Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, and there'll still be confessions here Wednesday night, but no daily Mass this coming week here at St. Bede. There's still daily Mass at CCM down at William & Mary and at St. Olaf over in Norwich, so you can look at those websites to see when those times are if you're still interested in going. And just please see the liturgy schedule on the parish website and the upcoming weekend email for those opportunities, and we'll kind of continue to keep you posted on the liturgy schedule going forward as we navigate this with two priests for a little bit. And then as well today, as Deacon mentioned in his homily, is Word of God Sunday. And so we'd like to, in a special way, bless the lectors of the parish today. So I invite all those who are present here and serve our parish as lectors to please stand at this time. Dear friends in Christ, in the readings at Mass, the table of God's word is spread before the faithful, and the treasures of the Bible are open to them. You are entrusted with proclaiming this sacred scripture here in this holy sanctuary. In this ministry, you must be examples of Christian living in faith and conduct, and you must strive to grow in holiness through this proclamation of God's word. Let us pray. Everlasting God, when he read in the synagogue at Nazareth, your son proclaimed the good news of salvation for which he would give up his life. Bless now these lectors as they proclaim your words of life, strengthen their faith, that they may read with conviction and holiness and put into practice what they read. We ask this through Christ our Lord. And I invite everyone to now stand for the final blessing. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Go and announce the gospel of the Lord.
Join in singing number 775, You Call to Us, Lord Jesus, number 775.